talking to the curator, Elizabeth Wisworth, that, you know, it just has happened in Miami. We've received so much wonderful media attention. You all, we've had tremendous visitorship, you know, to see this exhibition. He has such an important, left such an important legacy in Miami, not just through his paintings, but through his very being. So many people knew him and loved him, and it was really a pleasure for me, coming from the door piece, to get to know his work. So I want to thank specifically Hortensio Soriano. I don't think of a round of applause for Hortensio. We've had a number of media events, and we're sort of like twins, sort of the same height, actually. And we can finish each other's sentences. She's come here generously, given up her time, and it's been a real pleasure to work with you, to play with you, and thank you for supporting this panel as well. I want to recognize FIU's Cuban Research Institute, Vicky's Cafe, and after this, I want everybody to please stay and show me how you play dominoes and other Cuban games, because we have this all set up outside. We also want to thank the Roxy Theater Group. Oh, I should mention that Vicky will receive 10% off of Cuba Libre, I think is what they're serving specially tonight. I want to thank the panelists, of course, Elizabeth Escueta, Alejandro Andres, and Adam Yon McHugh, and thank you for coming to Miami and participating today. Now I want to actually introduce our, probably somebody who doesn't need a lot of introduction, Dr. George Duane, Director of the Cuban Research Institute.
And I'd also like to ask the panelists to please take their seats over here. So thank you, Jordana, for your support of this event and also other events related to Cuban and Cuban American art. It's really a pleasure to co-sponsor today's panel discussion with the Frost Art Museum, and I want to acknowledge as well William Machado's work, the curator of education here, as well as my colleague Jaime Correa, who is now also taking this event for a lot of months of organizing and discussion as to the details, the practical details of the event. Before I introduce the speakers, I also want to ask Hortensia Soriano to please come and say a few words on behalf of her mom.
I want to thank everybody for spending an afternoon with us. Thank you for the Cuban Research Institute and Dr. Cordenwani for setting up. Really, this is the dream team panel. I mean, if you're going to have a panel, these are the people. So I'm so happy that they are here. I want to thank Dr. Jordana Pomeroy and the entire Frost team for showing so much love and care towards this exhibit. I want to thank Dr. Hernando Hales, for being here today. I have the good fortune of calling him mi hermano. See, we're both only children, so we kind of adopted each other. So you're kind of settled, okay? And so I also want to thank Dr. Adam McEwen for being here and adding her very knowledgeable and important voice to this panel. And most of all, I want to thank Elizabeth Osueda, who's an adjunct curator at the McMullen Museum and professor at Boston College, and curator and organizer of the artist exhibit. And wow, what an incredible exhibit she has really put together. And I want to thank you for taking me on this incredible adventure and for your friendship. I need to also mention Roberto Coas Amade, who is here with us from the Museo Nacional de Bellas Artes in Havana. And really, thanks to him, his collaboration with Elizabeth Osueda back in 2014 for the We Fail It On show, he brought a book of my father to Elizabeth, and that's really where the adventure began for the artist is listed. And I have to say that Alejandro Reo was the one that introduced me to Roberto Coas Amade. Back many years ago, we corresponded via email. So it's funny how the universe happens that here's a guy from New Jersey, introduces me to a guy from Havana, who then introduces a work to a woman from Boston, curates a brilliant exhibit in Boston, travels it to California, and then brings it on home to Miami to this beautiful Frost Art Museum. So I mean, you know, that's how the universe works, my friends. It's a beautiful thing. And we'd also like to recognize and thank Dr. Juan Martinez, Professor Emeritus here at FIU, and was very helpful also in getting the exhibit here. But I just want to say briefly about the Rafael Soriano Foundation. We have created it to preserve and encourage an understanding and appreciation of my father's artwork. We are also launched the website of the Rafael Soriano Foundation, which will be an incredible resource, I think, for scholars and anybody interested in my father's work and life. We are going to be working on archiving all the archival materials and turning them into the Smithsonian Archives for permanent, there will be warehouse permanently there and available to scholars all over the world. And we will be working on the catalog resume as well. And I want to thank my spouse's faith, who's really been a driving force in making that happen. So without further ado, let's get this dream team kind of going. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Hortensia. Thank you again for the support of the exhibit and today's event. So, as they all said, this is really a stellar panel, so I'm going to introduce you briefly to our talks and today's speakers. I'll begin with Elizabeth Thompson Borzueta, who teaches Hispanic studies at Boston College, and she has conducted research and written extensively on the relationship between art and literature in 20th century American Spain. She earned her MA and BA in art history at the University of Georgia. And at Boston College, she has curated several exhibitions, including this one that is now due here at the Frost. And I'll just mention a few others, Esteban Lisa, the Abstract Cabinet, which was on display last year. And she also curated and edited the catalogs for Rafael Soriano, The Artist is Mystic, Wilfredo Lam, Imagining New Worlds, 2014, and published in Spanish, also in 2016. And Amanda, Making an Invisible Visible, 2004. Our second speaker will be Alejandro Andreos, who's a professor of art history and American and Latino studies at William Patterson University in New Jersey. He earned his PhD and MA in art history at the Graduate Center, City University of New York, and his BA in art history from King College. He's written numerous essays, including Luis Cruz Azaceta, published in 2014, the first monograph on the artist's life and work. Mexican Muralism, A Critical History, published in 2012, and Orozco in Gringoland, The Year in New York, 2001, among many other books and publications. His work has appeared in Art Journal, Aslan, A Journal of Chicano Studies, Third Stacks, Art Nexus, and Encuentro de Guatemala. As a poet, he published Los Exiliados Suenan in 2013, and Memento Mori in 2012. Our third speaker will be Dr. Abigail McEwen, who is an associate professor of Latin American art history at the University of Maryland at College Park. She has conducted research and teaches on the modern Americas, particularly on the art of the 20th century in Cuba and Puerto Rico, and especially the post-war avant-garde. She received her PhD from the Institute of Fine Arts at New York University, and she's the author of the excellent book that we presented last night here at FIU, Revolutionary Horizons, Art and Polemics in 1950s Cuba. Her writings have appeared as well in numerous exhibition catalogs and professional journals, such as American Art, Art Nexus, Revista Hispánica Moderna, and Cuenta Cubana. And she has also participated as a curator in several exhibits at the Art Museum of the Americas and the Art Gallery of the University of Maryland at College Park. So that's our panel, and so we're going to start in that order with this person. So please help me welcome them again to the panel.
Thank you very much. I'm Elizabeth Borzueta, and I'm delighted to be here. And I just wanted to thank Jordana, first of all, for saying yes. Juan Martinez as well. Thank you for all your help, Rafael Millar. There's a long list, and of course, you all know from Hortensia that Roberto Cobas, with whom I was working on another project, the Wilfredo Lam exhibition, he and I were speaking, and he is the one who is instrumental for putting Soriano before me. So I wanted to thank all of them, and I wanted to thank my co-panelists, my esteemed co-panelists, Alejandro, because early on in the days he was willing to talk to me about the poets that were influenced by Soriano, Abby McEwen for her wonderful book and her research, which I was able to access, is I was putting together the catalog. The catalog also is a wonderful reproduction. It was produced at my home university, Boston College. And I also wanted to give a big shout out to Gordy, who did the photographs here, because they're just really stunning. And if there's one thing that's very tricky, is to catch Soriano with the right luminosity and the right light behind it. So he did a fabulous job, and we're very happy with the catalog. So, having said that, I thought that what might be the most interesting thing for you today, since I do have this esteemed panel of art historians, I thought it might be best if I let the art history be discussed by the art historians. And since my training is both one of being a daughter of a sculptor, so my father was a sculptor, and I spent my childhood, some of my childhood in Mexico, looking at the muralist painters and some of those sculptures, I thought my training is really through literature. And my training is through literature, specifically surrealism. And so Spanish surrealism, Latin American writers, and this intersection, this confluence between literature and art. So I thought that might be interesting to you, because you've probably been exposed to some of these essays by now. It might be interesting for you to kind of find out how this was born, this project was born, and how we kind of carried it to fruition, and what some of those intellectual ideas were that we were trying to look for and seeking out in this quest. So I have to say that not every exhibition is as blessed and as special as this one. So we've been, from beginning to end, we've been very blessed with a lot of good karma, a lot of good universe, wonderful people to work with, wonderful collectors, museums. And so this really made a project that was very special from the beginning. I remember when we were putting together this project, we came to Jordana and Pomeroy, the director of the Frost Museum, and we suggested to her that this might be something wonderful for Miami as well as for Boston and then Long Beach. And she, after some discussion, you know, she posed this question to me, why would it be interesting for Miami? This is another Cuban artist, and I said, because this is another Cuban artist that really has a global resonance and something that transcends really just Miami and transcends the Cuban-Miami label. And he's really an international homeboy that's gone very far and gone on the long game. So it's really important that Miami realizes what a treasure he is. And for me personally, I'll delve into that a little bit. I was working on an exhibition on Wilfredo Lam, who was another Cuban artist of the second generation. There were three generations that I'm sure my esteemed colleagues will go into. But he was in the second generation. He was born in the beginning of the 20th century and then died about 1982, so 1902 to 1982. And I had been in Cuba and working with my colleague Roberto Cobas Amate from the Museo Nacional de Bellas Artes. And he began talking to me of Rafael Soriano. When he came to Boston, and he was a courageous fellow because he came to Boston in November, and he came with this beautiful linen suit, and I remember picking him up at the airport, and he brought a catalog of a great show that was done at the Lowe Museum in 2011. And I was immediately fascinated and intrigued by this artist. I think one of the things that intrigued me are the different periods that he was able to master. First, his geometric abstract expressionism, so that geometric concrete art, if you will, that even though you have these solid, flat angles and planes, there was a depth to the colors that you could see resonating stage after stage in his work, and I think if you go upstairs, you'll see that. So first, these geometric or concrete shapes and forms, which when I was working with Roberto Mata
and I was working with Wilfredo Lam. I was much more oriented towards surrealism and those kind of biomorphic shapes. So I was immediately intrigued by that. I was intrigued by the conversation that I hope Abby will go into, the dialogue, if you will, between the geometric, abstract artist and the biomorphic, organic, abstract artist in the decade of 1950 Cuba. So there was kind of this dialogue, if you will. One was waning, so that was the abstract morphology that was about 1953 to 55. And then there was the more concrete geometric abstraction that was waxing and coming into its own. And this confluence, this dialogue, happened in 1955 and took form in a beautiful exhibition at the Museo Nacional de Bellas Artes in 1955 with the sculptures of Agustín Cárdenas and also the beautiful paintings of our friend Rafael Soriano. So we began to see this conversation that was developing not only between these two artists, but between all of the artists of the 50s and this third generation of extraordinary visual artistic output. The next period was really after the revolution. So when Fidel Castro marched into Havana in 1959, there was great euphoria for the arts, for architecture, and the Cuba concrete artists, really began to gather as a group, and they called themselves Los Diez Pintores Concretos. And this group of artists really embraced concrete abstraction and thought that they were going to be able to continue to paint and in this way. And what happened was the revolution redefined its precepts. They were not allowed, these artists were not given the unfettered kind of expression that they had experienced in 1959, so that by 1962, Rafael Soriano had decided to leave, and he came to Miami along with many other artists who decided to seek freedom in their art and their painting. But this transition was so traumatic in Rafael Soriano's words that he could not paint. So he stopped painting, literally, for years. And in his interviews and in his words, he explains that he was traumatized. And the concrete art that he had been exploring no longer provided him with the emotional sustenance to continue painting in this way. So he began in exile a series of experimentations. And what I thought was so fascinating was that he retrieved the surrealist imagery that was brought to him and that we saw in a lot of archival information, because unfortunately we don't have a lot of those paintings from 1940. But those paintings that he was painting in the 40s, this surrealist imagery, was now being retrieved. But it was now being sifted through these decades and years and emotions that he was experiencing. And what happened was this very unique expression of surrealist imagery in the late 60s and 70s that he began to explore in order to explain this type of event that had so deeply affected him. So the depth and the profundity of this experience continued to grow throughout the decades, and in the and later in the 80s, he still was working with this tension that he had within him between surrealism and abstraction. He was introducing the figure. He was exploring more of those biomorphic forms that he had been exposed to through the works of the Onfe, those that first biomorphic, organic, abstract group in Cuba. And he started to open up these shapes, open up these forms, tap into this biomorphic, organic, surrealist imagery. And what happens then by the 90s is he finally decides to resolve this tension by embracing both surrealism and abstraction. So you see these remnants of the concrete geometric forms that now begin to morph into a more three-dimensional shape, very sculptural, if you will, and yet they still reflect the angular aspect. So you can see where he was in the 80s, and you can also see where he's going to. So what he does in the late 80s and 90s is he embraces this abstraction, embraces the surrealism, and comes up with what is uniquely Soriano. It is like nothing else I've ever seen. So yes, you will see me writing all these labels in politics, saying in the early part, you know, he in the early 60s, maybe he's retrieving the surrealist imagery. He's a lot like Wilfredo Lam, or he's a lot like Roberto Mata, or Rufino Tamayo, or even in the 80s, he's like John Arp, or he's like Hans Bellmar. But actually, when you look at a Soriano, it is a Soriano, right, Alejandro? I mean, when you look at his work, it can only be his work. And then as you go through this journey, this quest, you are actually engaged in this human quest, this universal quest for what humanity is, what your experience in life is. And I think by the time he gets to the late 90s, he's starting to delve into these questions of what is this intersection between life and death, and what is the meaning of life and death. And he does it in an exquisite way in which he is able to actually paint with these colors. And I remember I was so affected by Alejandro's essay in the Loeb catalog, because he actually, as an art historian, and not a pseudo art historian like myself, he actually likens his work to the painter's painter. He calls Soriano the painter's painter, whereby he likens him to a Rembrandt or Velázquez, and even the Velázquez he had, I remember I walked into his bedroom in his home, and he had right across from his bed, he had a portrait of Velázquez, Las Meninas, you know, the famous Las Meninas that's hanging up in the Prado. And so, you know from his erudition and his scholarliness and his professorship at the art school in Matanzas that he was very well educated, bien instruido, and that carried him through in those lonely moments when he arrived in Miami and had no art community. It wasn't the art community it is today. He had to go inside himself to look for this spiritual sustenance, and he did say, geometrics was no longer enough for me. I began to paint. I am a spiritual person. I believe in God. So he did have that orientation, and he went inward, much in the way that Roberto Mata would go inward for like the instincts or the psychological morphologies, but he was going inward to look for that kind of sustenance that he could paint from. He wasn't painting for a gallery, he wasn't painting for a museum, he wasn't painting for clients. In fact, sometimes he didn't have that. But that is precisely what afforded him the freedom to follow his own vision and to follow his own heart. And so I use in my essay, I actually use one of the poems from St. John of the Cross, who was a 16th century mystic monk, he basically has a beautiful poem where he basically talks about this inspiration from light. And I think this contrast of light and dark that we see so clearly in Rafael Soriano's work, which is very reminiscent of Spain's golden age, the Baroque age, chiaroscuro, claroscuro, and this great contrast, we see that in a profound way in his later works. And that is precisely what is so compelling about his work. And T.S. Eliot has this wonderful poem from Little Gidding, which I can't really remember, but I'll do my best. And it talks about, and we seek to explore, and the end is when we come, I'm not T.S. Eliot, and I can't remember it, I should reference it, maybe I will. let me read it to you, because I think that it's truly sums up Rafael Soriano very well. And this is my catalog, so I should be able to find it. Okay. Aunque no tengo mis gafas. La vejez tiene cara de verbo. So, T.S. Eliot's Little Gideon. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. And that, for me, is Rafael Soriano. Thank you.
By trying to frame Soriano's generation. And of course, we know that through the scholarship of many scholars, but particularly one that's in the room with us, my dear friend Juan Martinez, you have the first avant-garde. These are artists born at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th. They come of age in the late 20s, the early 30s. Then you have the second, which tends to be the artists born in the teens. They come of age more into the late 30s, early 40s. And then Soriano definitely is part of the third avant-garde, artists born in the 1920s, who come of age late 40s and into the 50s. What I think is significant about his particular generation is that they are teenagers or very young men right after the traumatic frustration of the 1933 revolution in Cuba. Okay, so that's definitely part of a kind of historical trauma in the background. They then come of age with the promise of democracy in the 1940s. Let us remember that Cuba was a constitutional democracy from 1940 until the early 50s with the Batista coup. And then, of course, that generation was also marked by the frustration of constitutional democracy being disrupted by the Batista coup of the early 50s. That very generation would be full of a great deal of optimism in the promised revolution that was on its way by 1959. And then, of course, you have within that very generation a profound sense of frustration when the revolution that they believed was going to be democratic, a different kind of nationalism, ended up being something else. And though you have that shift from these moments of historical trauma that then propel a significant part of that generation into exile, basically starting in 1959. And I think that it's important to see Soriano and his generation within that framework. Because that tells us a great deal about what the experience of exile did to them and how it transformed their work. I can think of two other artists, and this is something that I deal with in the essay in the catalog, who are of the same generation of Soriano, Agustin Fernandez and Roberto Escopiñán, who had very mature modern styles in the 1950s. But then after their exile, their art, like Soriano, goes through a radical transformation. And the transformation is one that has to reflect the pain of the experience of exile. What happens now? The language that they have been connected to as artists, connected to formalism, basically gives way to something else. there are all of these different ways of thinking about the sense of displacement, and you need to set down roots once again. And so we see this, as Elizabeth mentioned, that he arrives in 1962, the spring of 62, to Miami. He goes into a funk, to use a popular word, that he's not able to then paint for a couple of years. And then once he starts to come back, you see how his style is basically leaving behind the geometric vocabulary, and Abby will, I'm sure, speak very eloquently about that. And you start to see how he starts to reconnect with the influence of surrealism early on, which of course is a very potent visual vocabulary for that generation of artists, not just in Cuba, but throughout Latin America. And you start to see this evolution, how the forms start to become more free, more organic, they're biomorphic. His use of space does connect to the earlier work, because there's always this quality, even in his flattest geometric works, of trying to pursue a kind of fourth dimension. And so we see the sense of space opening up in these paintings as he's moving through the 70s and then, of course, into the 80s with the full maturity. The, you know, to use a phrase in Spanish, los plenos poderes that he arrives at, right? He's in fully empowered as an artist when he gets to that point. But here's where I think it's significant to point something that is essential in understanding his work. One of the reasons why he's able to do this is because he is an extraordinary painter. He is a painter's painter. The way Velázquez is a painter's painter, or Zurbarán, or Bonnard, or Mark Rothko. And so I think it's very significant to always remember that about him. Talking via email with Roberto Covas a number of years ago, he was telling that he was always quite taken when he would look at Soriano's concrete works in the collection of the Museo Nacional, because they were always more painterly than the other concrete work of his contemporaries. And so you can see that in the exhibition, the wonderful examples that are there, the way he handles the paint. There is a love for the very nature of paint, how the pigment functions on the surface of the canvas. And that is a very significant part of his sensibility as an artist. He's an extraordinary technician, but technique in and of itself, without an inner life, just ends up being a kind of academic mechanical repetition. And so his inner life is what facilitates this great métier as an artist to really take a deep breath and then let it out. And we see how this starts to happen as his work achieves the maturity that it does, specifically in the 1980s and the 1990s. His forms are quite extraordinary because they're biomorphic, they're organic, they evoke figures without ever literally representing figures. There is a sensitivity that they communicate that makes us think of a kind of metaphysical experience. And that experience is asking us to do something that connects to what Elizabeth was saying about St. John of the Cross. It's a kind of, he takes us into a dark night of the soul. And he basically tells us, okay, we have to go through this dark night of the soul, and then you need to take a leap to go beyond that. And you could literally see that in many of his paintings. Some of his paintings project a sense of anxiety and unease. I think some of the marvelous heads that are in the exhibition definitely communicate that. But they go beyond that sense of anxiety and unease. They are an invitation to jump forward, to take a risk, to see what possibilities are there between suffering, and that suffering can bring transcendence. You know, it's interesting because when I think of his work, he is one of a handful of artists that I always think immediately as going beyond Cuban art, but also going beyond Latin American art. A number of years ago, when I was very, very young, I didn't even shave back then, I had the opportunity to visit Soriano studio. And one of the things that I will always remember was his incredible modesty in bringing out a painting and just placing it on the easel. Not having to go off into any kind of verbiage about the work, just saying, you know, this is what I've been working on, and then he would pull something else out, and this is what I've been working on. And it was just extraordinary to see these beautiful paintings, because they are beautiful paintings, they're not pretty paintings. Because these beautiful paintings are asking us, as viewers, to do something that went beyond just looking. They were asking us to see. Seeing is a much more meditative, thoughtful process that then allows us to see what the work is revealing to us. And so that is what they were doing. I was fortunate that in that visit, I had the companionship, and actually that's the reason why I went, because I was, you know, a kid who didn't know much of anything, who wanted at that point to be a visual artist. And I was with these terrific, extraordinary humanoid men, José Gomesicre and Enrique Lavado Cruz. And Gomesicre, of course, you know, would talk about their connection with Matanzas, that you can always see the blues of the Bay of Matanzas in the way Soriano uses blue in his pictures, and I think that's absolutely true. And Labrador, who was a bit more of a rough, wonderful character, once we have been looking at least 6 or 8 paintings, there was a pause and there was silence, and Labrador, who had a wonderful smoker and drinker's voice, simply said, and of course, I cannot translate. But I don't think we need it. Soriano is an artist that we can only compare with the early work of Armando Morales, Tamayo's work at his very best, and I would say Tamayo of the 50s, the work of Fernando Sisto, Rothko, obviously. Maybe the not as well-known work of William Baziotis. These are painters who are very much in love with the nature of paint. They are painters' painters, but they choose not to stay just on the wonderful handling of the material. They become explorers. They project a kind of discomforting metaphysics for us. They challenge us to do something more than just look channels to see in the painting. And I think by doing that, he provides one of the really great adventures of 20th century painting. He is an explorer, and we are fortunate when we're invited to go on the journey with him. And going back to the Said quote, of course, exile can be a damnation, but it can also be the beginning of liberation. And I think what Soriano went through in his life and work definitely proves that the taste, the need, the profound desire to be free to express yourself is always the beginning of any great adventure or creativity such as this.
Carreño in particular was a real advocate, a proselytizer for abstract abstraction from the start of the 1950s and through the end of the decade, through 1957 at the very least, the time he left Cuba for Chile. At the same time, even though Soriano was very much associated with what became concrete art, he was always, in a way, a very idiosyncratic member of that generation. Concrete art, canonically, refers to art with no reference, no allusion to the natural world. Going back to his first articulation in 1930, Bruno Caris by Theo van Doesburg, concrete art is purely intellectual, a rational relationship created by tensions, dynamics of form and color. For Soriano, although his geometric paintings of the 1950s certainly explore this dynamism, the relationship of color and form, they're not purely rational. And what is so remarkable about Carreño, as Alejandro was saying, is the sensitivity, kind of implicit, embedded, even embodied in his geometric paintings, even from the 1950s. For his solo exhibition in Matanzas, going back to 1947, he wrote this in the catalog. This is in a very loose translation. To be touched by images that are realized in the center of that divine force we call soul. Images that live and that are the truth of our inner world, reality of our psychic world. Images of space, thrown into space, that come to life through the wonderful language of drawing. So there is implicitly kind of psychic contention, being spiritual, already alive in Soriano's work from the late 1940s. This is the time before his work becomes geometric. There's a lyricism, I think a very compelling musicality to his work that develops sort of in this time, kind of in Matanzas, as he's moving toward greater and greater geometric kind of abstraction. Soriano was younger than Carreño. He was slightly senior to some of Pozzolose, the group of gestural painters that Elizabeth referred to. Working in Matanzas, he also had a kind of distance from Havana, in ways that I think were creative and liberating for him to be able to work independently and not quite so much in the crosshairs of Havana, under Batista, in the context of abstraction that was becoming ideological and used in political ways. But no doubt the evolution of his geometric abstraction, his painting, happened, as Elizabeth explained, through the long decade of the 1950s, which saw the first the very quick and tumultuous arrival of gesture painting through the work of Nicolas Wanse, who created group in 1953, showed a number of times before they dissolved in 1955. In some ways, their early exhibitions, the critical, the creative, the force that they unleashed, in part as an act of resistance against their predecessors, Havana School, an earlier iteration of Carreño's painting, but also after 1952 against Batista, really even a foot in Cuban art on the map in a way, establishing a third generation kind of vanguardia, a presence that was a new iteration of what modern Cuban art could be, both for a local Havana-based Cuban art audience, but also internationally. These were artists that began to be shown from Sao Paulo to Venice to New York. So in a way, Cuban modernism became for far more of a transnational phenomenon at this moment. With the dissolution of Los Once, geometric abstraction, as Elizabeth said, did rise to the forefront, certainly by the end of the decade. This trend country, led by Cabello, was catalyzed by the arrival of Lobo Soldevilla Villa to Havana from Paris in 1956. She brought with her a personal collection of works on paper, principally, from the School of Paris. So from artists, for instance, Delaunay, Leger, French artists, European artists, Cuban artists had not seen in person. And so to have access to current trends in geometric abstraction was, for Soriano, for so many other artists, really instrumental in giving them access to what was happening at a kind of first-hand basis in Cuba, but also elsewhere in the world. Soldevilla, with her partner, Pedro de Ora, opened the Gallery of Color Luz the following year, 1957. That became a real, in a way, a bastion for Cuban modernism, for the vanguardia at that time, in a very difficult moment in Cuban history. Politically, it was an incubator for geometric abstraction, certainly for younger artists, but like Soriano, the home, the gallery, was a meeting place, a place for exhibitions. It was nominally a commercial gallery, but of course we didn't really sell with anything at all. But in terms of fostering a kind of esprit de corps, a kind of solidarity around geometric abstraction, the gallery and the moment, the movement that they inspire, is important. This group of artists, including Soldevilla, Jordi Ara, Martínez Pedro, eventually consolidated into the 10, Los Diez, the 10 concrete painters, in 1959. The group was quite short-lived. They had only 3 exhibitions. In a way, they came too late, almost in their time. Of course, they have even mounted exhibitions at all in 1957, 1958. Was, at least in their minds, a kind of resistance to the very dark days of the Batista dictatorship. So to have art, to believe in art, not exhibitions, was an act of a belief in the power of art itself. For what it's worth, you know, the abstract artists, the Cofrancos, believed that the language of geometry was in fact revolutionary. They did not support the Batista dictatorship, but in the end, they were disappointed by the revolution, which did not seize upon that aesthetic, the very utopian idealism of geometry, its universality. In Cuba, unlike in the Soviet Union, there was never an explicit decree against abstraction. It was much more oblique. Within the revolution, everything, outside it, nothing. That said, many of the abstract artists found more challenging conditions. They worked in exhibitions, many of them left the island. Seemed that the regime favored figurative art, pop art, abstraction had fallen out of favor. Perhaps because it had been so tied to the idealism, the aspirational mentality of the 1950s, when so much hope seemed to be invested in these lines, in these colors. This idea of concrete art, geometric abstraction, had its end, came to a point of closure around 1961, 1962, the year that Soriano left Cuba. For many decades, this period of Cuban vanguardia art was scrubbed from the walls of the National Museum in Havana, in a way, a forgotten episode from the past. Of course, the art has reappeared around from the turn of the century. There has been much newer attention, interest in this moment, which I think is promising and auspicious. Certainly the 1950s abstraction was a very polarizing decade for many reasons. But the recent interest in recuperating this moment, Cuban abstraction within larger discourses in Cuban art, but also Latin America, transnational, global, and modernism, feels important and also overdue. And for Soriano to be included in this conversation is, of course, important. His work is really an essential part of this dialogue. It's not like Andre was saying, not only within Cuban art, but on a much broader and really global scale.
For your wonderful presentation, for making my job so much easier, because you were very concise and very precise. Before we turn over to discussion, just a few rules. In order to maximize participation, we'd like to ask you to keep your questions short. If possible, address one of the speakers or all of them, and then we may be able to take a few questions so that they have no time to think about it, and then a second round of questions. So we'll start with the first question.
Question?
Good.
I agree fully in what Elizabeth says. Normally, in every article that I will see, I always find a reference. And references for me are important.
I'm sorry
to
interrupt
you. Did you get that
cell phone?
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, go ahead.
And references for me are important either to work with analysis or not to work with analysis. Normally I try to find those that don't have any analysis, which is practically impossible, especially even in historical terms. On these early works, and this is one of my questions, I see I have the opportunity to have a number of these works that have a strong material presence. And I know of only one from the mural that visited Cuba and could have been influential, but not in the way that matter was used. And the only two artists that I saw that used it very strongly was one was Carreño, and the other one was Soriano. Soriano had a much more different color pattern. If, do you have any idea who was influential on him on this particular period? The matter was used to define some geometric figures as to us raising the level of the painting and the use of sound.
So, I
just want to make sure I understood the question because I'm having a hard time hearing. But in terms of influences on Soriano, at what period, please?
1953 to 1957.
So I would say from 53 and 57, one of the wonderful parts of this journey, and as a researcher, is that you find information that hasn't been mined before. And one of the things that I found to be quite interesting on him as a third generation Cuban artist was that he, much like the second generation, he was sent to Mexico, and he was directly involved with and in seeing and in visiting with Diego Rivera and Orozco and Siqueiros. And Siqueiros was probably his biggest influence. So there's a fabulous photo, and it's, I'm not sure if it's upstairs in the, is it upstairs in the vitrine? And it shows him standing next to one of Diego Rivera's great big mural paintings. And then we juxtaposed it against one of his murals, which was very primitivist, and it's also in the book, and concrete, as Abby was mentioning. But it had that same feeling of primitivism.
Now that you mentioned, it makes total sense.
Yeah.
The first paintings of Diego Rivera, 1911 to 1914, they have sand, and they are geometric in pattern. And I can see perfectly well, you know, the visions that Soriano did in 1956 to the influence of Diego Rivera for the first surrealism.
So I think you would be really interested to take a peek at the vitrine upstairs and to see this juxtaposition, for me, it was very mind-boggling to see that this translation, if you will, of primitivism, but with these geometric concrete forms, was picture, image, really, with what Diego Rivera was doing. So I invite you to go up and take a look at that.
I do.
Can we see if there's any other question, please? Just to, there's a question in the back.
Sir.
Thank you. We can come back to your question.
Yeah, that's okay.
Where's the other question?
Way in the back.
Okay. When you hold the mic, hold it close to your mouth like this.
And please remember to keep your question short so that we can have
okay. Hi, Abby. Okay, my question is, I would like to know the earliest manifestation of abstraction in Cuba. I mean, from my research, I found Ernesto González Puig from 1934 to 36, very art performance. That's the earliest I've found. So I just wanted to know if any of you here have found earlier than González Puig.
Thank you. We'll turn it over to Pam. Abby, do you want to comment?
Alejandro Amigo, you're better than I could. In terms of dating abstraction, someone like Colalocchi, who was looking at Italian futurism, who was in Italy, that's an early point of reference. Someone like Enrique Limarón, was also working in very early moment, early 30s, in the kind of geometric abstraction. Roberto Diago, whom Soriano and Roberto Hansas, they taught together at school, was also an early exponent of abstraction. There are artists, not as early as the 1930s, but someone like Julio Corona in New York, working in a Magistro,
well,
not in the very early
30s. Well, there's an article on Ernesto González Puig that Elsa Vega wrote for the magazine, Cuban Art Magazine. And there's a few pictures of Ernesto's work. And I recommend anybody that's interested in checking that out. González Puig is a very, you know, underappreciated artist, as well as Ligarón. There's another figure by the name of Berenal, which he was doing work very, very early on, which is another figure that, you know, could be explored.
Thank you. Let's see if I have a little.
Thank you so much.
No, I just would add that, my easy answer is a second. But I think I do want to emphasize the importance of an entirely forgotten figure like Enrique Rivero. Enrique Rivero has some really innovative abstractions as early as 1931, 1932. Now, I know he becomes an eminent artist throughout his career, but, you know, the president is significant in the history of art. I think that's key. And obviously, overwhelming with this sort of post-Leger type of vocabulary, but Rivero is someone who really is worthy of attention and to study, particularly those works on their own.
Thank you. More questions?
Question.
Yes.
Yes, I have it. It always amazes me how the fact that the artist has to earn a living is ignored. To me, the key question for any artist that always pops into my head is, was his work selling during his lifetime? Could he make a living at it, or did he have to die to be recognized like so many artists do? This is a very big deal, and it just amazes me because it's always ignored.
Well, perhaps we should let the daughter speak, but the father's
he sold his work throughout his lifetime. Maybe we'll sell him more now. But he did sell, you know, it was usually just my mom and him in the back room, and he never really had a gallery represent him, but, you know, he sold here and there, and, you know, he was, uh, he he lived very modestly, so he didn't eat much. He had a day off, so he painted at night. He was a nighttime painter. And so he was able to retire, and he just kept painting, and he would sell every once in a while. Sure. Yeah.
I would add to that that in Cuba, of course, he earned his living after some substantial volunteer work in founding the School of Fine Arts in Matanzas as a teacher and as the director of the School of Fine Arts in Matanzas. And that also, I think, points out something significant about him and his generation, that these were very civic-minded young men and women. They were in the process of for Jarapapi. And so you have the generation of artists that come out of the late 40s, graduating from San Alejandro, and they go to Oriente, they go to Camagüey, to Las Villas, to Matanza, to open school of fine arts there. And Soriano was together with Roberto Villar, Lourdes Booth, and Rodolfo Tato, among the founders of the School of Fine Arts in Matanza, which is how he made his living until he came to Exile in 1962.
Elizabeth, I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about his return to painting after being in exile, you know, if there was anything that triggered his being able to start.
Okay, so the question is, she's asked to, for me to speak about his return to painting after he came to Miami in exile. I think that there's a wonderful painting upstairs in the gallery, and it's actually the painting that is placed on the easel. And that painting is called Gitana, La Gitana, and it's from 1965. So that was the earliest painting that we have saved that he painted when he came into exile and he began his exploration. And I love that painting, not necessarily because it's a masterpiece, if you will, but it foreshadows where he's going and it still reveals where he's been. So you see the great mastery of painting there from the first generation, from San Alejandro, the Academy, in Cuba, where he was, where his formation took place, his artistic formation. So you see remnants of maybe Matisse or interior landscape. So definitely Cubism. So you can tell he was, you know, definitely exposed to Picasso, to Matisse. But you also see that some of these great teachers from the first generation and second generation, which came as professors to him. That those remnants were there. So you see what later, you know, be characteristic in the second generation as these interior scenes, you know, Emilia Pelayes and the architectural remnants. In the center of the painting is a large window. And it looks like a window. It's very opaque. And it looks as though there's light streaming forth. And so you have a vision of where he's going or where he's trying to get to, which is this oniric luminosity that he's been quoted to have, this kind of dreamlike light illumination that floods the painting. And that really is so compelling. It draws the viewer towards this painting and towards his later paintings. So you see geometrics at the very top as a border. So you know that there's that relationship with geometrics. And of course you see La Gitana, the gypsy woman, holding La Guitarra, the guitar. And so you see these remnants, which are so classical to the Spanish tradition, the Latin American tradition, and you see at once, you know, this kind of brief capturing moment of who he was and where he's going. And I just wanted to relate very briefly an anecdote when Hortensia, Lisa, and I went to Matanzas to meet with his students. We met with one of his students who was 94. And she had a tertulia in her house. And afterwards, she spoke at this tertulia. And we presented with her another book on Rafael Soriano. Now, she had been 1 year younger, extremely beautiful, and a poet laureate, so she was a national poet. Her name is Carilda Oliver Lara. And she saw the cover of his book in which he had a mature painting. Now remember, She knew him as a professor. He left in 1962. She never saw him again. She never saw his paintings, his late paintings. On the cover of this is Renuncio de un Sueño. It's a beautiful late piece from the 80s. And she looks at it, and she begins to cry. And she says, now I understand what he was trying to tell me. At the height of his career in Cuba, he was recognized at the National Museum of Fine Arts at 35 years old as being one of the bright stars, rising stars. But she told us that he had turned to her and he said, this is not the way I want to paint. This is not my future. I want something else, but I don't know what it is. And so for her in that moment, it was having these two pieces of the world come together. And so she was extremely grateful to have that and to see where he ended up painting.
This is really more for Elizabeth. Just wondering what the, if you can comment on the difference in the reception to this exhibition in at the McMullen up in Boston and California and here in Miami. How has it been received or seen differently by audiences and by the media?
Well, that's a very interesting question because in Boston, you know, we're not like you are here in Miami. We don't have the wealth of knowledge that Alejandro Andreu, you know, has stored up, in part because he's, you know, born of this and also because he was a student. I think many of you have been exposed to Soriano and you know him in many different facets and walks of your life. We did not know who he was. So at the same time that presented to us a wonderfully blank canvas that we could draw upon and that we could present his work to. So he was very much embraced by the Boston and the New York communities, and they loved his art. And I have to tell you that even without reading the wall text or the painting labels or the essays, people respond to Soriano's work as a painter. And I think, you know, what Alejandro has, the leitmotif that Alejandro continues to express is that we had people come up and say, I've never heard of him, I never saw him, and it's a revelation to me. So I think that they very much loved his work, and so there's a whole lot of Boston aficionados up there and in the Northeast. In Long Beach, we had a different experience and a beautiful experience. I think context changes the way Soriano is read and interpreted. And we had a beautiful museum that was right up against the water. And there, a lot of seeing Soriano's paintings juxtaposed against this beautiful water led us to think what it must have been like to be in Matanzas and to see the changing of the colors up to seven times a day in the Bay of Matanzas. And it was welcome there and had a beautiful installation as well. And then we come here to Miami, and this is the toughest crowd, of course, because we don't have that empty canvas and we can't just interpret as we want to interpret, because there's a whole lot of people who really know Soriano and know Cuban work. And we hope that you've liked the presentation. We think that the installation at the Frost is a gorgeous installation. And we think the ceilings and the height of those ceilings in a certain way lead to the ascension quality that Soriano has implicit to his work. But I guess the jury's out. You guys will have to tell me on the last question, how it's been received here in Miami. We're quaking in our boots, hoping that you really like it. But we are very happy, and you've done a great job with publicity.
Yes. In that context, what took so long for Soriano to now be recognized? What? Why now?
Okay, so I do have to say that there was a marvelous exhibition of Soriano's work at the Mo Museum in 2011. And I want to give due recognition to that because that was the impetus really for this exhibition. So we don't compete, we continue to build on each other's experiences. And Alejandro wrote for that, Jose Jesus Rosado also, many others. And so I think, and I'm going to defer to the art historians on the panel, but I think there is a certain sense of momentum that happens at a certain moment of time where people begin to take notice, and the accumulation of interest and exhibitions starts to bring into this wellspring of recognition. And I think Soriano is at that point now.
A small comment. There's been tremendous interest in geometric abstraction from Latin America, going back perhaps 15 years now. The inclusion of Cuba within that dialogue, which has been based in Brazil, Venezuela, Argentina, is a relatively more recent phenomenon, going back to Buenos Aires' Cold America, America Fria, and that exhibition, which included the Havanas of Avangard, including Soriano. I think there's been tremendous interest in these concrete Cuban artists, particularly people like Lobo Soldevilla, Henry Darier, David Turner, a gallery in New York and London had a show devoted to this movement, which I think also contributed to its momentum. So in a way, I think, in terms of why Soriano now, it's a new generational moment around geometric abstraction and then somewhat more laterally around Cuba specifically. I think his geometric work has had a lot of publicity. I think this show will go a long way toward introducing people to the next decades of his work, which are in some ways much more complex and even more important in some ways.
I would only add that it's a process, and it takes time, and so the process, unfortunately, sometimes it happens after the artist is done, which is really an awful thing that happens all the time. But I think it's an accumulation of new voices in the scholarship, rethinking and reframing the work, doing exhibitions, seeing the artist outside of the immediate context. For example, last year there was an exhibition in Munich at the Kunsthaus called Postwar 1945-65. Now, Soriano's work was not included in the exhibition, but they had a work by Darier, and within this massive chronology, and I could have sent a photocopy, they included a photo of a Soriano exhibition in Cuba. So you can see that I think it's, certain things are congealing because of all of these scholarly and curatorial labors. And I also wanted to say that I think this is also the right time historically to also look at the generation of Soriano that came into exile. Artists born in the 20s and early 30s who came here, their styles were transformed, and then they produced a substantial body of work in the years of exile. And just to do a little plug for Abby's upcoming project, Abby is working on a scholarly project dealing with the effects of that historical situation among that generation of artists in the exile. So it's, hopefully this will continue and the work will become better known and properly contextualized.
So I'm sorry, so before the Low exhibit, really Soriano wasn't exhibited?
No, there have been exhibitions in many here in Miami. I know, as Effie was saying, that also there's kind of a groundswell of interest in the concrete and abstraction in not only Cuba, but also Latin America. I know the Juan Marc Foundation also has done cold abstraction. And so they've looked at this whole relative kind of continent and rethinking that. And I think we as scholars also in universities, we're looking at Latin America and looking at that in many different interdisciplinary facets, whether it be literary, theological, and I have to actually make a little plug because my husband contributed, and he's a theologian, so he contributed an essay. But that is to say that Latin America in the university world, in the research world, is certainly experiencing a renaissance as well.
Yeah.
You know what I would add, that outside of scholarship and curators, Soriano's work has always been known and admired by painters. I know there's a number of painters in the audience that I recognize you. And so because he's a painter's painter, that has always been a known fact that he's really an extraordinary painter's painter. I was fortunate to be friends with both the late Armando Morales and Fernando de Sisos, and he was an artist that they always brought up. In the same breath as they would say, Tamayo, Rafa, Soriano, El Cubano, and Soriano. So within painters, he has always been acknowledged as a terrific artist.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have one more question.
Well, my name is Celio Beltran, not very well known here. But I'd like to say something. I remember when Alejandro Leos, and I know him so well, when he was so very, very young. And when he's talking about Jose Gomez Segre and Enrique Labrador Ruiz, really reached my soul, because I also met particularly Gomez Segre. No, Enrique Labrador Ruiz, in New York, sobre todo, porque vino de Cuba. Pero lo que quiero mencionar es la riqueza que hay aquí en Miami. La riqueza de los reyes de talento que expresan todo este contenido tan interesante. Recuerdo a Rafael Soriano en dos o tres ocasiones exposiciones en Miami, el corto tiempo que vivimos aquí, y nunca me dejé de percibir la profundidad espiritual del trabajo. Y es muy importante, y yo celebro haber conocido a Alejandro, a Ruiz, este personaje tremendo. Pero lo que estamos hablando aquí también es la poca seguridad que tienen algunos pintores que piensan que tienen que morir primero. Creo que todos vamos por ahí. Pero la riqueza mía está en que personas como Alejandro seguirán después de pasar nosotros y que podrán seguir descubriendo cosas. Es la espiritualidad en el trabajo de Soriano, está también en muchos otros. La profundidad es difícil de ver muchas veces, pero yo bendigo este momento por él y por nosotros.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias. As the museum educator here, I just wanted to interject a very personal comment. We have here as well teachers from the school across the street, and I've had the pleasure. I knew of Soriano. I came from Cuba when I was 2, but I've had the pleasure of learning so much more about him, the person, that it's been an amazing thing for me. And we're all talking about adults experiencing this art. But when you bring in a fifth grade class of students and they get it, I had goosebumps. I just couldn't believe it. So these students have all come from the school multiple times, and they look and they look and they look and they get it. And that was, I think, the most amazing moment of up to now of anything I've ever done. It was fabulous. So I just wanted to share that with all of you, that there is a future where these kids learn to appreciate Soriano, possibly study him as well.
Thank you. I think we can come back to the first gentleman who had, are we here, Ian? I had another question and I didn't give another chance.
Oh,
well.
Oh,
is there anything else that anyone wants to
okay.
Ask?
Okay, we're coming to the end.
I practically had forgotten. So just one last, I think more a question and a participation. So it's true he doesn't have any reference. And it's true that being sorts of primordial, there would not be other than further influence. So what are we going to call? Maybe Sorianism? And I hope it is. You know? So, but that's a question as well, because if, how are we going to refer to this?
Well, I can tell you, as the curator, that was the challenge. It was, and I think I brought that up in my introduction, just, is this surrealism? Is this abstraction? Is this, what is this? You know, and so finally, you know, I came to the realization at a certain point that in the 80s, in the mature style, I think really what he did is he retrieved a lot of those influences, the Cuban influences, the Surrealist influences, the primitivism, the muralism, and he was able to, you know, I think in the beginning he was at odds with that. There was tension, there was struggle. If you look at those 70 pieces, you see vestiges of the geometrics, but you see this morphology that keeps inserting itself, and then you see surrealism. So you see the struggle, and maybe that's part of the answer, is that there is a struggle, and struggle is not necessarily implicitly bad. And I think Alejandro spoke to that, that there was within that struggle a transcendence. And what we call it is a lot of wall labels, a lot of wall text, but I do think he resolved it by embracing both abstraction in its multifaceted form, whether it's biomorphic or geometric, and then he wedded that to surrealism, and we come up with Soriano.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for the panel. Thank you all for being here. And Miriam will say the last word.
Oh, okay. I like that. We are very thankful that you're all here today with us, and our panel is absolutely fantastic. We do have an opportunity to visit the gallery upstairs on the second floor. I believe that you all will join our guest today. So that's the best experience, I gotta tell you. When you go up there with these folks and Hortensia, you'll learn everything you can possibly imagine about Soriano. After that, you're welcome to come back and join us for Cuban Trivia Night. We have prizes. Okay, well, thank you very much, all of you.